So yes, thank you very much, everyone, for joining us for this talk, which is Young People's Digital Trends. My name is Andrew Collins, and I'm the Communications and Engagement Officer at ProMo-Cymru. I'll be honest, I don't really know why I included the picture. I mean, the likelihood is you're probably looking at me on the webcam now. So that's me with a haircut. But anyway, that's me. I'm an English graduate with qualifications in Google, AdWords, Analytics, and partner status for Google Nonprofit. So that's through ProMo-Cymru. I used to be a secondary school teacher as well. My colleague who's monitoring the chat and will be joining us for the Q&A later is Diana. Diana is the multimedia producer and director at ProMo. And as you can see, she has a degree in audiovisual communications and TV directing. So if you've got any questions about sort of video, because that's going to be a big topic throughout today's talk, please do keep those questions for her. I mean, you might even be able to ask her during the talk. I'm putting her on the spot now, Diana. But yeah, she'll certainly be joining us for the Q&A at the end. Right, okay, using your chat, I thought we'd get off to a bit of a flying start and have a bit of fun because it is Wednesday afternoon, after all, we're over the hump. So I'm going to challenge you to see how much you know about youth language. When I say youth language, I mean sort of the acronyms that they might use on social media channels. So I'm going to give you a couple of letters, and I'd like you in the chat to see if you can tell me what it means in sort of instant message speak. So we're just going to give, I think what we'll have to do is the winner will be the first person who correctly identifies what it is and puts it in the chat. So let's see, I'm just going to open my chat here a sec. So you're going to have to be really fast. Okay, number one. TY, let's see who's going to be the first person to correctly. Oh, Rachel, that was absolutely rapid. I'm very impressed. I didn't even have time to drink my coffee. You're absolutely right, that's of course. Thank you. That's a nice, easy one to get us started. Well done, Emma, as well. Fantastic. Okay, number two. We're going to get a little bit harder as they go down. IRL. Oh, unbelievable. Who's that? That's Bryony. Bryony gets the win there. It is indeed in real life, which is one of those kind of funny things, I suppose. It just seems ridiculous that we even say it. But yeah, of course, we had these like digital versions of ourselves, I guess. Okay, IKR. Rachel and Sasha, very good. Teresa, excellent. Mari, is it? I know, right. Excellent. Very, very good. Okay, the next one's, I reckon, maybe the hardest one on the list. It's definitely a shout out to the Reddit crew. Holla. TLDR. TLDR. Yes, Bryony. Amazing. Good job. Yeah, well done, Eric. Very impressive. Yeah, it is too long, didn't read, or it can be don't read, kind of same thing. But it's basically when this is used is like if people want to post a really long bit of information and people can't be bothered to read the whole paragraph, the whole article, you can like summarize it in two or three sentences, basically. So it's like a way of summarizing your whole post, but like super quick and easy. But yeah, awesome. Good job if you got that. Okay, the last one is, oh, sorry, I'm not sure if you can see it. There we go, the big reveal. P-O-S. P-O-S. S. Now this is the one that I think might be of interest to those parents that are amongst us. This is definitely taking the longest. Oh, point of sale, nice. Yeah, that's not the one I'm going for. It is, Eric, it's a totally legitimate answer. But Dean, congratulations. It is absolutely right. It is parent over shoulder. So if you ever see that as a parent and you see them messaging that, that basically means that now the talk is going to be clean for the next 2 minutes. But also you'll be like, well, hang on, I know that you're talking about something you definitely shouldn't be talking about there. I did that question with a group a couple of weeks ago and I got the answer, piece of something that I probably can't say in this webinar. Technically, I suppose it could also be that as well. But the one that it's most used for apparently is parent over shoulder. Great, thank you very much for taking part. Brilliant. So that kind of lays the foundations of what we're gonna be talking about today, which is understanding youth trends with regard to digital. And I suppose really the point to bear in mind is it's a constant work in progress because we are always one step behind. But, you know, it's part of our job to make sure that we are no further behind than that. Anyway, starting with social media. Social media is in decline. Probably not the sort of thing you would have expected me to start this presentation with, bearing in mind it's a talk on social media. But it is, in actual fact, 41% of people, now this is not just regards to youth, this is right across the board, but 41% are actively trying to use it less. 39% have deleted an account in the last year or uninstalled it or just uninstalled off their phone, uninstalled the app. And the average use now, this is a global figure for all age ranges, but the average use is now 1 hour and 53 minutes per day. What's particularly interesting is that that is actually a decrease. It's a decrease on the previous year, a decrease of 1 minute. Now, I admit that doesn't sound massively important, but they've been recording the statistics for a number of years. And that number has gone up consistently 10, 15 minutes year on year. So actually, even though it's only a 1 minute decrease, it suggests a trend that actually it should have gone up, we would have expected, by 15 minutes. So actually that's like a swing of about 16 minutes of average use time compared to previous years and what we'd expect for growth. So why is that then? I think there are probably three key reasons. I'm sure there are others, but these are the three that I kind of think are probably the most likely contributing factors to this. Number one is notification burnout. Now, I can guarantee if you are watching this on your laptop and you have put your phone to one side and you're very vigilant and you don't check your phone for the entire duration of this talk, you will go back to your phone and you will have notifications from Twitter, Instagram, emails, WhatsApp, your Facebook Messenger groups, maybe something from Facebook. And it is a killer. We're all getting sick to death of it. It's basically this idea that it's now becoming like life admin. And that little red dot above all of our apps is driving us wild. And it's kind of forcing us to just give up and uninstall all of them. It's one of the reasons why I've uninstalled Facebook for my phone. It's not that I have stopped using it so much. I just can't be bothered with all the notifications coming through all the time. Another one is oversaturation. That's particularly kind of for the demographic of like mid-30s, because that age range has been on social media since the early days. Now, if you're like me, you were a child of the MySpace generation. Again, all love and respect to the MySpace squad. It was amazing. We had a great time. It was like the first time I think social media kind of really existed. And although we've seen obviously massive changes in the way social media works, really, it's kind of the same thing. You know, Facebook, Instagram, the idea is you tell people what you've been up to. Here's a photo of what I'm up to. And I'm hoping people respond and react positively to that. You know, although we've seen kind of changes, the core premise of social media hasn't actually changed for 15 years. And finally, lack of trust. Now, this has really kind of been a grower since things like Brexit, where things happened with Cambridge Analytica, people not really being as trusting with their data as they used to. I think we all used to just like sign up to various apps and social networks and just assume that, you know, that's fine. You know, if we don't like it, we'll just uninstall it. But we're now a lot more savvy around our data. And I think we take a bit more care and caution when we sign up to these things. So that's probably another reason why people are going, well, actually, I don't necessarily trust Facebook anymore. So maybe they're deleting the apps off their phones. So they feel like they're kind of getting a bit more control over that. Despite that, of course, that is not to say that social media is dying, not by a long stretch. 98% of internet users use social network in the last month. What it actually tells us is that while people are using fewer social networks, they're spending more time on their preferred one or two. So now people are saying, I don't want Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat and TikTok and whatever else. They go, I'm just going to use Twitter because that's the one that I personally like the most. So they spend more time on the one that they actually like rather than like kind of spreading their time thinly, if you like, and getting all these notifications. What that means for us as organizations is that we need to be very careful about which social network we choose and make sure it's right for our audience. I'm assuming that if you're here for this talk, the likelihood is that young people are one of your audiences. Of course, they're not all. You've still got professionals and others to kind of engage with, but I assume that that's going to be of some use to you. And we must make sure that content is tailored specifically for that platform. A few years ago, it used to be the case that you just go on like Hootsuite, schedule a load of posts across all your networks and yeah, job done, go home for the weekend. That's kind of not really okay anymore. Like we can't, people are a lot more, they can tell when we're not really using the network properly and they don't engage with us. So we have to tailor our content for those platforms much more. Okay, that was like a global idea with all these age ranges. We at ProMo-Cymru wanted to find out how that information that we knew already about older people, is that replicated in young people? So last year, just before all of lockdown started and we could actually go outside and meet people, we conducted 12 consultation sessions, engaging with over 130 young people from across Cardiff, going basically mostly through youth centres to kind of work with young people. It was like a conversation. We had some structure to it, but we just wanted to kind of find out as much as possible about how are they using the internet. So the first part of this talk, really, I'm going to be talking to you about the results of that, just in case it's of any use. That is going to be quite a lot of information. And so if you fall asleep on me, I don't blame you, but please do wake up because we'll be getting to TikTok and that's just pure fun. So stick with me for this, but I promise it's worth it. Okay, here's some of the main facts that we found out. First of all, 100% of the young people we spoke to use at least one social media platform every single day. Now, that's not a surprise, but it is important. You know, we know that they're using it and we know that that's where we need to be. Instagram was the most popular, followed by TikTok, Snapchat, and Facebook. I would be really interested to rerun that question now, because I think since lockdown, I think there's a possibility that TikTok may have replaced Instagram. It's certainly going to be a lot closer because Instagram was wildly the most popular, but I think it'd be a lot more of a close run thing now. The youngest person we spoke to was a 7-year-old who used Snapchat several hours a day, which is crazy, but there you go. Okay, what else did we find out? The vast majority spend more than 3.5 hours on social media every day. And there was a trend, again, nothing surprising here, but there was a trend that the older they get, the longer they spend on social media. We had one boy tell us that on a school night, it would be like 3-4 hours after school. On a weekend, he would be up until 3-4 o'clock in the morning, mostly just looking at videos on YouTube, looking at social media. So, you know, they spend a lot of time on. With regards to what they like, this was where we started to kind of drill down into a bit more useful information. It became really clear that actually what they're looking for is an account that gives them a clearly defined purpose. So for example, that might be they just want Fortnite. They just want 100% Fortnite or FIFA or whatever it is, Call of Duty. But they might want like makeup tutorials. They might want pranks, aspirational content, or just following famous people. What they didn't like is when people broke that brand. So if I post all the time about Fortnite and suddenly I'm posting FIFA, that's not okay. That's not a good enough thing to do. You are an expert in one thing and one thing only. Now that's interesting, but it's also really challenging for us. If you work with young people and you kind of think, what is my defined purpose? We might be able to think, well, actually, okay, if you look at the Sprouts, one of our projects, our purpose is to provide youth information to the young people of Cardiff. But how do we make sure that our content is that level of defined? It's a real challenge, and we have to think about that. Looking to how they use websites, despite using their phones and social media for like all this time, they are not using websites. Like websites are essentially dead to them. They're not using them for anything other than shopping. And even then, most of the time it's apps. So actually they'll occasionally go on the website to like look for shoes or bags or whatever. But actually they were not using any website consistently, even for things like news. Some of the older ones, they had the BBC News app or the Sky News app or whatever. They had like a news feed of some sort. They would use Twitter. But nobody was using a website, like a blogging website, to get their information. On average, young people spent just 30 minutes a day on websites. And again, the younger ones, zero time whatsoever. Only 10%, one in 10, could name a blogging site they actually regularly read. And even that was like pulling teeth. It was sort of saying, oh, do you tell us more about it? And they could barely, they say, oh, I know it's called, what is it called? Something. So they'll occasionally read stuff. But again, that's certainly the older ones. Most receive their information via social media. And of course, with all the kind of fake news, the actual real fake news, that is a concern. And again, we need to think about that as digital youth workers, because if that's where they're getting their information, how do they know it's right and correct and trustworthy? Finding information online. So this is if you're looking to get a solution to a problem, if you're worried about something. If they didn't know the name of the exact service they needed, they just said they'd Google it. But when I actually kind of pushed them with an example to say, okay, so let's say that you had this particular problem, you wanted to find, you wanted to find out something to do with getting maybe like an STD check, let's say. What I found was that they were actually surprisingly poor at using Google. I think people of a certain generation, probably myself included, we've used the internet for so long that it kind of feels like second nature to us. But it was really surprising to see that they were not very good at searching and sort of formulating a common sense phrase that was going to get them to the results they needed on a search engine. And when they did eventually formulate that search, they would look at no more than three websites. If they didn't get the information they wanted, that's it, they were done. That they were just done. And like each website, it was like, I'm going to scroll through this page, barely read a thing. If there's no pictures or video, I'm not going to bother. Go back. What's the next one on the Google search list? So you do not have long to impress them and capture their attention and hold their attention if you're using a website that provides information. Last couple of things, video. Now we've already known video is king. We know that it has been the case for like a decade or more now. But while every single respondent said they would prefer video over text, it was quite sweet and it was quite sweet that they all acknowledged that a combination of both was better. I think they were all saying, oh, I think, you know, I like video, but other people might like to read. But what was interesting was 100% of them said they would actually prefer video. So I think what the point is that they would expect to find text with a video and that's not going to put them off. But 100% of the kids we spoke to were just going to watch the video. They weren't going to read, unfortunately. I'm going to stop on this one just for a little bit longer because we will come back to this later. What's happening with video is really interesting. We're seeing a real split between short form video and long form video. Now for years, YouTube has just been king of all things video. But they're having some of their market taken off them by these kind of young upstarts like TikTok and Triller. So these are the short form videos that are like kind of 15 to 60 seconds maximum. The long form is much more longer content. And actually YouTube seems to be positioning itself. They're quite happy with that moniker, I suppose. The way that we kind of like to explain the difference here is you can put yourself in their position. Let's say that you're on a train going to work. The short form video is that time where you're commuting. So whereas we might maybe scroll through Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or whatever, when they're on the bus to and from school or kind of just like in breaks, that's when they're looking at this short form stuff. The long form stuff, a bit like for us, when we get home and maybe we put on Netflix or iPlayer, that's when they maybe go to something more like YouTube or Mixer. Now, I'm going to stop there for a second. Just using the chat, does anybody know, have you heard of Mixer? I'll have to just open my chat a second, see if anyone has heard of or is familiar with Mixer. I think there are other ones. In fact, there's probably maybe even a more famous one. I can't think of off the top of my head now. Mixer is a gaming streaming site. So I forget what's the other one called, not Switch. Oh, the name's gone completely from my head. Twitch, thank you, thanks Sasha. Yeah, absolutely. So Twitch is kind of the biggest game streaming site. So like big video game players will literally just play live and people will, like young people will just watch them play. It seems like such an alien concept. If you're like me and you kind of used to, you know, enjoy playing video games, that's like, oh, you're really old. No one plays video games anymore. They watch people playing video games. And yeah, Mixer is Microsoft's version of that, that they're trying to take that share of the marketplace there. But that's kind of how we can differentiate the difference between short and long form video. I think this is the final one. We wanted to look at ads in particular, because as anyone that's involved in marketing knows, it's incredibly hard to kind of penetrate through to your audience when it's just such an overwhelmingly busy place to get your message heard. And actually, social media ads do provide exceptionally good value for money. But we wanted to know, do they work? So of the people we spoke to, about 60% said that they didn't mind paid ads on Instagram and were happy to click on links, though most of the time this was only if it was something they were genuinely interested in, like shopping. Most of them were actually glad to answer a poll on a story, as long as it was like a one question and just bam, done, and they're on to the next story on their kind of like timeline. With regard to YouTube, so if you want to like put your video ahead of somebody else's video playing, they generally will skip ad as soon as possible, and that's normally either 5 or 10 seconds in, unless it really grabs their attention. So if you are interested in doing kind of video advertising, you need to make sure that either it's an incredibly short advert or you make it incredibly exciting with the opening 5 seconds, grab their attention and get your point across as quickly as possible. Okay, so let's summarize back through all of that. Social media is where young people are at and they like their content to be clearly defined. They know what they're getting. They do not read websites. the information must come to them. They don't go looking for it. We need to make sure that we provide information in the places that they are. Video rules, regardless of which type of content it is, and perhaps we need to consider how we make short form and long form content that appeals to them. And creative, attractive ads can resonate and get through to our audiences. Okie dokie, I promised you that once we got through all the stats, I would show you some videos. So I'm going to launch a quick poll because I want to know, just out of interest from the people that are here, what is your opinion of TikTok? Hopefully you've just had a pop-up on your desktop or whatever you're viewing on. So you should have a couple of questions there about, well, one question, how do you feel about TikTok? Cool, okay, I think we've got about 30% of people have voted so far. Fantastic, we've got a few more to come. I'll give you another kind of 10 seconds because there are still answers coming in, Okay, I think we'll call it there. So we've had 30 responses and let's share what we had. So the good news is everyone has heard of TikTok. Good news. The slight majority have heard of it, but either don't get it or have heard of it, but can't stand it. Fair, totally fair enough. And 30% of you, OMG, you love TikTok. I am firmly in the OMG camp. So I'm hoping that over the next couple of slides, I can kind of convince you to jump from one of those two other ones into the OMG category. So I'd like to show you some examples of why I think that not only is TikTok just a great fun platform, but it's a platform that we need to be really aware of if we work with young people. So although I'm going to kind of focus on TikTok, TikTok is what we keep calling short form video. It's 15 to 60 second videos. There are others. So although TikTok is right now the main one, we're seeing that already Instagram has kind of copied it and added in their own function called Instagram Reels. There's another one called Triller, which they're trying to make big in the US. I know Donald Trump has moved on to that one because I know he's obviously not too keen on TikTok. And there are others. You know, I think even YouTube has actually launched its own short form video format for the time being, although it doesn't seem very popular right now. But the point is, this isn't going anywhere. This form of social media content is here for the foreseeable future. This is big. If you think about it, social media started as text, then it became images. Now it's the natural progression that we all want video. It's more engaging. We don't have to think as hard about stuff. Okay, I'm going to play you a couple of videos. So I'm hoping that this will all come through your headphones and stuff. Oh, and I know what's going to happen here. There you go. Right. I've skipped the slide. Sorry. Let's go back. So yeah, all he would just say is this is going to come through your headphones and it might be a bit loud. So I don't want to give anyone tinnitus by the end of this presentation. So just turn your headphones down a little bit just so that, you know, the volume level is right for you. Okay, here's our first video coming up now. What's so special about it? Seems really basic, just three guys dancing away to a song. Okay, so I bet you have all heard that song, particularly in the last like 3 or 4 months. I think that you'll find a lot of people, we will have heard it really, really recently. In actual fact, what you might not know is that that song originally came out in the UK back in November last year, so almost 12 months ago. It didn't even reach the top 10 when first released. It was something like 11 or 12 in the charts. Then what happened was those three boys made that video as a dance challenge on TikTok. And from there, it went crazy. So many people were doing this dance challenge. I guess the kind of the fun of it is actually quite an easy dance to learn. And I suppose that's kind of what makes it engaging. If it was too impressive, no one would be able to copy it and have a go. So as a direct result of this song being used on those videos, we'll show you a few more. But that song went on to, came, so this video was in March. And from about March through to May for about 8 weeks, that song was number one in the UK charts. And you can start to see just how much TikTok is influencing popular culture. Oh, also I'll show you this one. So the idea with TikTok generally is once one of these videos kind of gets released, everyone sees it as like a challenge to recreate their own version. So we're going to have a look at a couple of versions that got done, obviously, post-lockdown. So obviously that video was done sort of around late March, early April time, when of course we were in full lockdown and everyone was clapping for carers. And that video went huge because you've got kind of these nurses or doctors kind of trying to take a moment out from being on the front line to do something a little bit fun, and people wanted to show support for it. The other thing that kind of was very fun about these challenges is quite often is that they take them to new extremes. So sometimes that will mean doing these dances in more and more ridiculous locations, like maybe on the top of the Shard or something crazy, builders on the building site. But of course you couldn't do any of that because lockdown happened and young people couldn't go out and do these dance crazes with their friends. So this whole new phenomenon started on TikTok, which was hashtag pull in a parent, because who else are you going to do these videos with?
Dad.
What?
It's time to do this.
No, really?
Amazing. I love it. But yeah, so more and more we were seeing grandparents getting involved, everybody getting involved. So pulling a parent then became like the hashtag of lockdown one, I suppose. Who knows if it'll come back in the next couple of weeks. I want to show you a few more examples. That was just looking at how one dance craze can kind of just blow up on TikTok and how you can kind of easily take part in it yourself. But there are other aspects to TikTok that make it popular. So one of those things is this one on the left. Now I have a feeling it's going to skip my slide again, isn't it? Nope, no, it is.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, so this one is an example of like a filter you can use on TikTok. So you can see at the top of their screen, they've got name, place, animal, thing, and a letter. That's not something they've done. There's like a filter you can use, so they haven't got any like technical skills to do that. Anyone can really can do this very, very quickly, just kind of with a touch of a button. But the idea being you play the game, you know, name, place, animal, thing, it shows you a letter. And it's quite clever because that rolls over your head, the letter kind of randomizes, and as soon as you put your hand up, it stops on the letter. So it's kind of like a really fun, clever, interactive filter. Anyway, this one is just kind of a funny example because, spoiler alert, it goes a little bit wrong.
L. Ellie. Egypt. Euthanasia. Oh, wait, no.
Unbelievable. So euthanasia is a country, according to our friend on the left there. We're doomed. This is my favorite TikTok video. Now, if you're still not with me on TikTok and you're kind of going, I still don't really get it. This was the video that did it for me. Oh, sorry. So simple, but so brilliant. It's fantastic. So a little example of, again, how a craze can take off. This one was called like the Adele challenge. So anyone could have a go with it. You just use the same 15 second clip. And again, you don't need a lot of technical expertise. You can call like they call it remix or use the audio essentially from that video. And you can do your own. So people would do ones where it went all the way through the house. Maybe it was like people had unfolded paper clips. They were stood up like triangles. And of course they go bigger and bigger and bigger. So they're running all the way through the street. You know, it's like a challenge that people take on and spend a bit of time because the more ridiculous, the more funny and the more views. But then of course you also get these spin-offs. So a little bit like with pulling a parent, which is something we just didn't expect to happen. You then get the Adele challenge fail, where someone has set up dominoes across the whole house. They start their recording and as they pan around, the cat has knocked over half the dominoes and they're having to start all over again from scratch. So they kind of tend to generate their own kind of life almost. They take on a whole new beast and they kind of just hang around for normally a couple of weeks on end. I'll show you very quickly the Will Smith one. This was really just to let you know that big celebs are now in it.
I don't do the most, but I do a lot. Shoot the shot.
Yo,
I'm coming in.
guess I'm on TikTok now. That was weird, though.
I mean, that's very, very clever kind of camera trickery and video editing that's going on there. I mean, that's, you can't do that easily. They are experts. They've got a lot of money to spend. But what I wanted to show you was big celebrities are now using it. Even Will Smith, who is definitely not the age demographic that should be using this platform. Go on, we'll keep going with a couple more. So I just wanted to introduce you to Welsh TikTok, which, because ProMo-Cymru are obviously based in Wales. And I also wanted to introduce you to something called Duet. So this is a function whereby someone can record a video and anyone, absolutely anyone in the world, can duet with them. That means they create a video where they're on one side and you can respond and react to them on the other side. So I will only show you the first couple of seconds of this one.
Stop. Are you aware that you are crossed into Welsh TikTok? Right, okay. Please state your name. And in the words of our Lord and Saviour, Tom Jones, what's your name, love? Right, here we go. Now, I have noticed you haven't got a sheep with you. Is there a reason for that? I'll take your word for it.
Okay, I'm not going to show you the whole thing because I want to show you now somebody duetting with him. So you can see that he was actually leaving a pause on purpose because it then gives people the opportunity to engage with the video and remix it, if you like, for a better word, but duet with him and almost have this conversation. Oops, oh, sorry.
Stop.
Oh, I am.
Are you aware that you are crossed into Welsh TikTok?
Yeah, of course, I'm the Prince of Welsh TikTok.
Right, okay. Please state your name.
Ellis.
And in the words of our Lord and Saviour, Tom Jones, what's your name, love?
Ellis, love.
Right, here we go. Now, I have noticed you haven't got a sheep with you. Is there a reason for that?
Me and our Shana trying to look for him, we are.
I'll take your word for it.
Oh, star, thank you.
There we go. And do you like raisins in your Welsh cakes?
I love them, can't get enough of them. I'll take a full bag of raisins myself.
Well then.
I know, I'm one of a kind.
Here we go, heard it all.
There we are.
Right, and can you speak Welsh?
Of course.
It's all right if you don't, we don't judge.
Oh, that's lush.
Here we go, can you pronounce Llanelli?
Llanelli.
Okay. And what's your mother's name?
Andrea.
Bloody hell, is it? How's she doing?
Oh, she's far by.
Oh, tell her I wish her well.
Yes, well done. Oh my God.
Right, well, there we go. Everything seems to be all right. So here's a complimentary bag of Welsh cakes and our safe journeys.
Oh, thank you very much.
So there we are, Chris, out of Welsh Twitter. Welcome. So you get the idea again. So you can kind of remix these videos and there's lots of creative ways you can have a lot of fun with it. And again, thinking of it, again, coming back to kind of this professional idea, there are things that we can do here. You know, we can encourage people to get involved with it, you know, by asking questions, by encouraging duets. This is why it's such a fun platform. The other thing I just wanted to touch on before we move on to the slightly more serious side of TikTok with some potential professional use is most of the videos I've shown you are all really, really lo-fi. That's the big difference, I would say, between this and Instagram. If you're familiar with Instagram, it's such an aspirational network that the quality of your photography has to be amazing. You have to be a beautiful person. You have to be eating the most amazing food in the most glamorous hotels and the most beautiful locations in the world on holiday and sun. And you have to look like you're in, you know, the only way is Essex or Love Island or something. TikTok right now does not have that at all. Look, that guy has just made a funny video. He's in his bedroom. It might even be like a uni room looking at it. He's not made a huge amount of effort. He's propped his phone up and he just records himself, both of these people. Even the one with like the Adele sweets, they're just gummy bears on the floor. They didn't even look particularly high quality because the content is more important than the quality of the production value, I suppose. That's why I think it's not actually as intimidating a network to get into as you think. Just before we move on, you can see this is just, I mean, I could have gone on for ages, but these are just some examples of the people that have gone on and interacted with him and done their own duet with him. So you can see how many he got. I mean, this got like just hundreds of thousands of views, all these different duets and all these different people kind of taking part and getting involved. It's really good fun. Okay, looking ahead to slightly more serious TikTok, I just wanted to show you these two examples and then I will kind of put TikTok to one side until the Q&A. This lady on the left-hand side is Dr. Julie Smith. She's kind of known as like the TikTok psychologist. She basically just uses the platform to spread either inspirational messages or just kind of spread, if not sort of hope, I suppose, but even like things to be aware of and ways that you can look after yourself, especially during lockdown. Oh, sorry, every time. Let's try that again.
four signs of self-sabotage. One, procrastination. Two, making promises to yourself and then breaking them. Three, refusing to seek support even though you know it might be helpful. Four, prioritizing comfort over progress. All of these things are self-betrayal because we convince ourselves that we don't want the things that actually are really important to us. Things like self-medicating with food and alcohol, they seem small and insignificant in the moment, but they add up and they change how we feel. And once we lose trust in our own words and our own promises, then we lose our own confidence and we lose hope. And then we stop even trying to begin to make changes. So make one small promise to yourself today and then make it your absolute priority to keep it. That will start a new habit of keeping your promises to yourself.
Again, I mean, amazing content, but lo-fi. You know, she just spoke about what she knows, put a camera up. I mean, the background's not even particularly impressive. She just spoke to the camera and spoke well, and what she's saying resonates with young people. You can see some of the comments there in the middle. Those comments are from her video, nearly 2,000 comments and growing, and they're nearly all incredibly positive or worryingly resonating. But even if it resonates, at least it means that people are more aware and they may be more inclined to go and seek help. This is the final one I'm going to show you, I think. So this is actually a similar kind of video, but it's actually done by a young person. Predictable, wasn't it? There you go.
We fell in love, but it didn't last. 'Cause the second I figure it out, it pushes me away. And I won't fight for love if you won't meet me halfway. And I say that I'm through, but this song's still for you.
So I don't think I need to say much more, but that's really powerful. Obviously, a lot of planning went into it, and she had to kind of, I guess, film it throughout the course of the day. But it's incredibly powerful, and you know, she's just doing it all on her mobile phone and documenting it, I guess. Okay, right, how are we doing for time? Let's have a look. Oh, it's quarter past already, goodness me. Right, I'm going to rattle through this last bit because I was hoping to cover some of this. This is something totally different to what we've been discussing. In the kind of blurb for this talk, we mentioned that we're going to be talking a little bit about how do you achieve real engagement online. And this is something that we ran as a little experiment in the start of June. So obviously being youth workers, we'd normally go out and see young people and we'd like to engage with them and we'd like to be youth led and we like to kind of get to know what they're thinking, get to know how they feel about stuff and involve them as much as possible in any new process we do. We haven't been able to do that for fairly obvious reasons. So we decided to run like this little digital engagement experiment with the aim of seeing whether we can kind of build this new brand through meaningful online engagement in the middle of a global pandemic. It seemed like kind of a bit of a challenge, but a way to say like for us to learn a little bit more about both young people and how they interact with social media. So how we did it? We came up with the idea of basically running 5 paid Instagram polls, asking questions around different like brand elements, visual elements, kind of to work out what they liked and what they don't like, kind of to think about the tastes with regard to digital marketing. And if we were going to create a whole new brand for digital youth information, what might that look like? So these images that I'm kind of putting up on the right hand side, these were like our concept ideas. So we just kind of quickly threw something together really simply. But the idea being that we put out these kind of Instagram story polls with 2 options, because Instagram doesn't really allow you to do any more than that anyway. But 2 really simple options. Which of these 2 do you prefer, A or B, 1 or 2, colorful, simple. And then really quickly, as in like the following day, the brand would update to reflect their decision-making. So it was just like, we wanted it to really happen in real time for it to be exciting and for basically, we wanted this whole project to be done in 2 weeks. So in order to do that, we had to like come up with all the different questions, come up with, think about the different permutations if they didn't necessarily choose options. You know, it ended up being this kind of really confusing tree of questions and different outcomes. But we wanted to kind of run it as quickly as possible and be reactive because we felt that real-time element was going to be important. In the end, this was kind of the design that we came up with. It's a little bit better than my concept. So we have some fantastic designers at Promo and they kind of helped turn this idea into something much more real. And we wanted it, having spoken to them, we wanted it just to feel incredibly clean from the start. So just white font on a black background, so that giving them the idea that this is nothing, this starts as nothing. And kind of we liked the name Unnamed Cardiff because that was kind of the point. It was unnamed, nothing was done yet. This was a project that they could shape and mold over the case of 2 weeks of just paid advertising posts. So the first question, I'm going to run you through some of the answers and how they got on. So we targeted the entire advert basically for 24 hours. We spent £12.50 on just question number one, 24 hours, and we only made sure that was advertised on Instagram stories to people in Cardiff. So we know that it reached over 16,500 young people in the area. Of that, 930 responded. And this still blows my mind. Despite being 460 and 400, there were 7 votes in it. It's crazy, from 900 votes. So we were kind of asking the question, do you prefer font number one or font number two? So we had 900 responses, and by the smallest, most ridiculous margin, option one was chosen. So we took that forward. So then how we reflected that on our profile, you can see that this was the original profile. We just had like a white question mark, kept it really bland. We then made sure that we updated our font from there onwards. So you can see on these posts that we've started putting out, we made sure that the font then was the one that they chose in font number one. And for those keen observers, it is the font that I've been using in this presentation as well. Minor detail. Question number two, we said, okay, which of these two like color palettes do you prefer? Do you prefer this kind of like bluish kind of pastel hue or the slightly brighter, bolder colors? Now this one was quite a clear winner. So again, we reached over 10,000 people, nearly 900 voted. Oh, and that number I didn't mention, the CPR is the cost per result. So it's like a penny, essentially, is what we're paying, less than a penny for every one of these results to come in. So that we're getting, you know, essentially 900 answers and we're going with the majority on this. So you can see then on the right-hand side, we then wanted to update our profile as quickly as possible to reflect their decision-making. So we obviously posted to say, yep, here's the result that you chose, but also we updated our profile picture. So it was still the question mark, but we wanted to integrate the colors into that question mark. So this is only like 2 or 3 days into the experiment. Onwards, we then had these two kind of designs of which we kind of wanted for the style going forward. Now, this is a shame because we actually preferred style number one to style number two. We really liked. So we've got that Cardiff Castle. There's the mount at Cardiff Castle, which is obviously fairly iconic for the city. We wanted to integrate that into the poster, but I think internally we all preferred number one and we were a little bit gutted to lose this one. So we had to take forward, because that was ultimately their decision, the style of number two. The other kind of piece of learning that we had from this is that although we still reached over 14,000 young people and spent a couple of pounds more, the results were much, much lower. And the main reason for that is because if you can see the button, well, again, we assume, if you can see the buttons here, they're actually much smaller than they were in the previous question. So I think maybe that was kind of made it easier to skip and maybe ignore. But just by making those buttons a tiny bit smaller, you can see that actually our cost per result went up by a lot. So we made sure not to make that mistake again. But again, it's all an experiment, it's all a bit of learning. Then for question number four, we finally wanted to reveal, because at this point we hadn't kind of done any reveal as to who this was, who was running it, what the project was even about. But we wanted to say, look, this experiment has been powered by the Sprouts. This is our youth information project for Cardiff, the sprout.co.uk. And we were kind of thinking, well, look, if this is successful, there's this possibility that maybe this branding can replace our old branding for the Sprout. So we kind of revealed that this is who was behind the project. And we said, well, look, which name do you prefer? And you can see there that, again, we have 570 results and a fairly clear 53%, fairly clear, preferred the Unnamed Cardiff. The last thing that we did towards the end of this fortnight was decide a logo. So again, we had kind of decided internally, we thought about this UCCD one, because Unnamed Cardiff, you look at it right to left, is UC and UC, sorry, oh, or up and down. But also in Welsh, it's a Caerdydd Dienw. So again, it kind of works quite nicely in backwards. So we really like that design. but we were well and truly put in our place because this one was the most overwhelming response. So we put a lot of money into this one for the last kind of hurrah to make sure that we had some really good engagement from it. And of the 1,300, over 1,000 went for this second logo, which, if I take you back a couple of slides, was here. So because we knew that they'd chosen that as their style, their preferred style choice, we kind of adapted that into the potential logo choice for them, and they overwhelmingly chose that. Now, what's interesting here is this is the vote that separated the most out of all the votes we did. The rest were really, really close together. This one is overwhelmingly for option two. And there's maybe already what we're seeing is possibly some brand awareness, because if they've already seen that logo once already and voted for it, or even just seen it, because even though we only had 320 responses here, 14,000 saw it. Maybe we're already getting brand awareness. Anyway, as you can see, then we kind of finished this and wrapped the little project up, updated the profile with a new logo, and everything then started to reflect what we were doing. So the whole cost of the experiment came to £95. It was wrapped up. I mean, there was obviously work going into it, a couple of days of work going into it. But we reached 85,000 young people in Cardiff and got 4,000 results from those young people. And we've kind of managed to, at the end of all this, build something that's kind of real. In terms of what we've learned from it, I mean, obviously, I'm not suggesting that this is going to replace real face-to-face consultation or engagement or working with young people, because you're going to get much better results when you actually work and engage with can be done. And so maybe going forward, we can think more about how do we integrate both into the way that we work. Okay, that brings my presentation to an end, and I think only just on time. So I'm happy to stick around. I'm not in a rush to go. Officially, I think we only have 5 minutes left, but I am more than happy to kind of stick around and take any questions that we've come in from anything we've spoken about so far. So I'm going to invite Diana to join me if you can. Diana? Fantastic. Thank you very much. Diana is here. If you've got any questions about the design aspects of social media, I'm pointing this way, she's this way on my screen, but Diana is absolutely 100% the person to ask, although I know she's terrified of the questions that might come in. So let's see, has anything come in so far? Apologies, it's been really difficult to keep an eye on the chat at the same time as presenting.
So, Andrew, while waiting for more questions, we have two from Joanna at the beginning of your presentation. I just made some notes. So Joanna, you know when you were explaining about social media in decline? So she has asked, has there been much change during COVID?
That's a really good question. So I don't have the information because they tend to do this like annually and there's always like a kind of delay to getting it out anyway. So realistically, we won't know probably for another year in terms of getting those stats available to us. But anecdotally, what I can 100% say is that TikTok has blown up since lockdown. And when you think about it, it kind of makes sense. You had all these young people that had been cast off from school. They had literally nothing to do for months on end. And actually TikTok was already big in like virtually every other country. Bizarrely, the UK was behind Germany, France, who had already picked up on TikTok. Whereas normally we're like kind of, we tend to be the front runners on these things, on trends. But yeah, so I would say that the one thing that has definitely changed is this massive, massive increase in TikTok use. I think young people just were looking for something to do, looking for stuff to do in the house, and it like kind of do something fun and frankly escape the bloody terror of what was going on in the real world, I think.
There is another one from Joanna that I made a note from the beginning. So are there notifications coming from paid advertisers rather than your friends on Facebook?
Generally, not so much. You don't get too much paid notifications. Normally what you get is it's the things you've kind of allowed the app to do. So for example, like with Facebook, one of the main reasons I just completely gave up on it in the end was, you know, you get notifications for things like, oh, someone you went to school with like 2 decades ago has posted for the first time in a while. And you're like, I don't even care. Why am I wasting my time with this? It's somebody's birthday that you're in uni with. Cool. Okay. So like, it's a lot of that sort of thing. It's a lot of, you might have missed this. And actually, the the sort of notifications that are actually from friends, like your WhatsApp group and your messages, that's kind of understandable. And actually what we are seeing, which I didn't really touch on the presentation, but certainly with an older demographic, there is a real move away from social media and a move towards small groups. So things like your WhatsApp groups, where you can maybe have like certain group of friends, or if you all watch the rugby or the football or whatever, you might have a group that's just you and your friends. And whereas you might have put that thought about, oh, I can't believe the Man United lost again, you might have used to put that up on Facebook, you're now instead putting it in like a private WhatsApp group. So we're seeing those notifications, but they tend to bother us a little bit less.
Here's another question from Mary. So I'm happy to take this one, if you want, Andrew. So Mary said it'd be interesting to get some top tips for both short and long-term video content. So I would like to explain, like, there is a big main difference between short and long, and that's how you create, and that's what you should be thinking when creating your content. So long term is normally like YouTube, Vimeo. So you normally go and search for the video. So those type of videos, you actively search for them. So it should be a topic that, you know, that is like how to, or things that you normally search. And the short forms are videos that normally appear on your social media. So they should be very engaging. So there is nothing you search for, they appear. So if they don't engage in your first seconds, there'll be a scroll and you will pass it. You won't engage with the short form. So that's the main difference, I will say, or a top tip.
Sorry, Diana. I'm just picking up on Rachel. I know I can see Rachel there has said, I think I've lost it. Where's that gone? Rachel. Oh, yeah. Notification wise, there's a Netflix documentary called The Social Dilemma, which goes into how these work. I haven't seen that. I know a few people have recommended it to me, and I think I'm definitely going to get around to watching it quite soon. I had to just Google as well, because there was another one that I watched about a year ago called The Great Hack. It's not quite the same. It's not really about the psychology of how these kind of like trigger things in our brain, which I think is what the Social Dilemma is about. But The Great Hack is about how a lot of Cambridge Analytics stuff happened, and likewise, equally terrifying, and it's mind-blowing. But yeah, if you're interested in that kind of thing, The Great Hack is terrifying and fascinating equally, as I'm sure it sounds like The Social Dilemma is.
There is another one from Tom, and I think you've prepared something about this, Andrew. So I hear about some disturbing videos shared with young people via TikTok. Is this a problem?
Yeah, that's a really good, it's an excellent question. And to be honest, I did have a couple of slides prepared on it, but it's, I assumed this question was going to come up, to be honest with you. So with regards to TikTok, look, there's a few things we need to be genuinely a little worried about, because yes, I mean, they're trying to get it banned in the US at the moment, unsuccessfully for the time being, but they are trying to get it banned because there's constant links between the Chinese government and what they're doing with our data. And that is definitely a concern. Likewise, what you've said there, there was a video, if you did see this, I think it was, 3-4 weeks ago, of a guy who, horrific story, who committed suicide live on video. And that video was shared over and over and over again on TikTok, but also, it has to be said, on other platforms. Instagram had the same issue. It was all over there for 48 hours. And there's nothing I can say to that. It's horrific. And yeah, it's, how can you possibly encourage someone to go on a network when that happens? But just to play devil's advocate for a moment, isn't that exactly the reason we should be there? Because if there are young people seeing this content without us as experts either providing some context or encouraging them not to watch it because of how much damage it can do to them, isn't that exactly our role? We should be in those places where there are the most risks to make sure that we are mitigating those risks and providing safe, reliable information to them. So we actually put something out on Instagram on one of our projects, Make Cymru, which is a helpline for young people in Wales. And we put a post out to say, look, you might have seen this video. It starts with this. Do not watch anymore. And actually, that was the most shared post we'd had in weeks, because even young people themselves, whether they've seen it or not, wanted to share that message that actually, look, don't involve in this, don't get engaged with it, don't watch it, it will do you no good. So I think, to give another example, there was, you may be familiar with, the girl's name, I've got it in a slide here, I forget her name, I'm very sorry. Molly Russell, apologies, I've got this slide here. So Molly Russell was a 14-year-old girl in England who, I think 3 years ago, she saw a lot of suicide and self-harm posts on Instagram. And I don't know if, I don't know exactly what happened, whether she became obsessed with it or whether the algorithm was essentially putting this stuff constantly feeding out to her because she'd searched it a couple of times, but she ended up taking her own life. And that's led to massive changes in social media, particularly Instagram. I only say it because, again, it's the same kind of thing, really. Like, it is a risk, and we have to be so careful on these networks, and we shouldn't just champion them. You know, we should treat them with a bit of care. But if we're not there in those spaces to provide information, then, you know, that's arguably worse and more dangerous than ultimately us having our data taken by the Chinese government, in my personal opinion.
There have been more comments, so I'm just going, because it moves quite fast. So Rachel, I'll check if there is anything that I'm missing from the top, but there is one from Rachel, and she said, what platform is Mike Camry on, please?
Yeah, sorry, apologies. It's Welsh, sort of Welsh for microphone. So we are a helpline for children, young people in Wales up to the age of 25. The easiest way to think of it, it's a little bit like Childline, but with a couple of key differences. Obviously, we are bilingual because we're funded by Welsh Government. We offer right through to the age of 25, whereas Childline stop at 18. And the main difference is, whereas Childline is a counselling service, essentially like a listening service, Mike is all about advocacy. So we provide kind of solutions, and we try to work with the young people to kind of either find a solution, or we can be an advocate for them on their behalf. So it means that we can, let's say there's an issue with the school, if the young person wants us to, we can talk to the school on their behalf. No, don't be silly. Yeah, it's a Welsh word, don't worry about it. So yeah, Make Cymru. I think, I don't know if one of my colleagues, maybe Cindy or Diana, perhaps will paste some of the website information in there. But it's, we do telephone, text, and instant message. And actually, with regards to this talk, nobody texts the helpline anymore. We get some calls, but overwhelmingly the highest number of contacts come through now instant message.
Just share the details with Mike. So there is another one from, I hope I can pronouncing correctly the name, you, Matthias. So how to develop young people's media savviness so they can deal with the negative aspect of social media?
That is an excellent question. And hands up, I don't think I have the answer to that. I mean, it's something that we in our sector have been trying to deal with. Again, we're always a step or two behind. I think it's difficult because on the one hand, young people are definitely more savvy at this stuff than us. You know, they decide what's popular, and then we struggle to catch up and work it out ourselves. By the time we've found out it's popular, they go, oh, we don't want to be on that anymore because you're on it. So we're always a couple of steps behind. But really, I mean, it's difficult. It's like, while they're savvy and that they get it, I don't think they do get a lot of the risks. And that's kind of just an ongoing piece of work. I mean, I'm reluctant to say this is something that should be done in schools, because as a former teacher, I know there's already a significant workload passed on to teachers. And every time there's more awareness raising to be done, it feels like it needs to go through the school. It's a really difficult challenge. I mean, maybe that could be unpacked as part of a PSE or whatever it's kind of called these days in school. But it is, it's a really, really difficult challenge, because the more we warn them of the risks in a way, the more they kind of bat them away. You know, oh, whatever, you know, it's nonsense. It won't happen to me. I think there has been a lot of work done on some areas, like sexting, kind of sharing photos online. I think hopefully it sounds like that's somewhat in decline, because a lot of work has been done there by some organizations. But in terms of just data, fake news, I know Google themselves were putting a lot of money into providing courses on fake news that went out to schools and stuff. But yeah, I mean, again, apologies, I'm not sure what the name was, but it's a really good question, and one that I can't answer. It's really tough. It's just something that we need to proactively try and do as and where possible. But I think it probably needs to be done a far more structured way, probably from government, I assume.
Sorry, I'm trying to chat in the meantime.
Oh, sorry. Diana.
I will say the last one that I think you answered already. It's a bit up, so I'm trying again. So it was from Edge 1261. So it says, excellent presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do you think county councils will benefit from having a TikTok account with certain messages worked out to send out possibly? COVID messages change so much, it's hard for most people to keep up. But will be a creative platform like this work or not?
So yeah, awesome. That's a really, really good question. Thanks, Ed. It'd be good to find out what county council you work in, if you're comfortable saying. So basically, since lockdown, I think myself and Diana and a couple of our colleagues, we have done so much training with charities, youth workers. I mean, we've worked with, I think, probably about 6 different youth councils in Wales just in the last kind of couple of weeks, as people are struggling to keep up and make sure their message is being heard digitally. First question, do I think they would benefit from having a TikTok account? Yes, as long as you put a bit of, obviously, need a bit of time and effort and thought to go into the video. I think hopefully in the examples I showed you, that it's not about, the content is what's important, not so much how you film it. It doesn't have to be, you know, really brilliant in terms of, you know, super, super editing quality or anything. It doesn't even have to be the best camera in the world. But if you can make a message that properly resonates with your young people, and probably I would say make it hyper local, because what's the thing that's going to make your account stand out? Thinking again earlier on, we spoke about they like a defined purpose. You know, I realistically for us and for a local county, your hyper local is probably what gives you your identity and gives you your target. So yes, I would say definitely worth having a TikTok account, definitely using that TikTok account to provide information about the latest COVID lockdown situation. We've been using Instagram stories mostly for that, and obviously Instagram posts, but that's another really, really good platform. If you're going to use Instagram, you're way better off using the stories function than the posts. People are engaging far more with the stories aspect of Instagram than they do the kind of normal feed. So I'd say that's another really good place to put the information. And it's a little bit easier to kind of get that information across in maybe slides, because you can have, like, you know, 5 different slides with the five key changes. And with regards to it being very hard for us to keep up, yeah, tell me about it. I mean, we're in Cardiff, so, well, I am. Diana's actually in Spain at the moment, so you've got completely different rules where you are. But yeah, I mean, we've got obviously Welsh government here that are dictating certain rules. Then Welsh government have then changed it so that we have localized rules. Meanwhile, you've got the UK government providing rules that are just for England and then just for the north of England. And now we've got the tier system. I mean, it's amazing how bad they've handled the PR side of this and getting a clear message out. It's incredible. But yeah, unfortunately, our job is to provide that information for young people. We ran a big campaign at the start of lockdown, again, using Mike's Instagram page. It seemed to be very successful because we were getting comments from young people saying all the messaging right now is being delivered by old, male, stale. White, male, and stale. White, male, and stale. So all the messages were coming from old white men in suits who were telling young people that you can't go out and hang out with your friends, you're not going to school, your exams are being cancelled. And so we made a real effort to make sure that we were translating essentially that into something that's a lot more youth friendly and youth appropriate. And I think that's where we did quite well actually at the start of lockdown. So in short answer, do I think it's worth having a TikTok? Yes, 100%. Don't worry about putting loads of content out. You don't have to be doing like a video a day or anything. If you do one a month, it doesn't really matter, but just put your time and effort into it and make it a bit of fun and look at what's trending on TikTok and kind of pick up on that.
I think that's all, Andrew.
Great.
So okay. Thank you very much. Lovely comments as well.
Yeah, thank you very much to everyone who came. I hope it's been useful for you. We will be sending the recording out on social media as well. So if you go to Twitter, it's just @ProMo-Cymru, all one word. You should be able to find it there. We'll be putting out probably tomorrow, realistically, by the time, because I'm probably going to go and have a lie down. Brilliant. But yeah, thank you so much for joining us. It's been lovely kind of getting to know you. I'll put my email address as well in the chat. So if anyone does have any questions they didn't have a chance to answer, or if they just want to chat further, you can give me an email. So it's just andrew@promo.cymru, or send us a message on Twitter. But yeah, otherwise, thank you very much. Thanks for joining us. And yeah, speak soon.
Thank you.